Can Gopi Chandana, Angara and Akshata markings be applied by all? On 2/8/2010, when in Mantralaya, my cell phone was ringing continuously after 7 p.m. It was the day on which the telecast of the serial had started. Knowledgeable persons started asking me, "Haven't you noticed that nothing is in conformity with the Madhva traditions?" Followed by telephonic calls on the following days, urging me to take some action about it. I told everyone that I shall talk about it after returning to Chennai and seeing the telecast. I saw the TV program after 4 days. Every character in the telecast was sporting the Gopi Chandana Nama like a U mark without knowing the proper way of applying it. There was a black streak at its center. Sannyasis were seen in Panchakacha, the style of wearing dhoti by those who are not recluses. And women were seen wearing saris in a manner that was different from the Madhva tradition. Likewise, the circular marking on their forehead, known as pottu, was also non-traditional. The conventional black bead adornment around the neck was conspicuous by its absence. In short, the different characters had been portrayed in the manner the producers had learnt about the various aspects connected with those from sources not well informed regarding the Madhva customs. I could not but help feeling that with a little attention, things could have been done properly. I then telephoned the person who had sought my guidance and told him, "You have acted well and so too the others, but without proper knowledge about Sri Raghavendra and the Madhva philosophy based on the principle of dualism that his forefathers had followed and Sri Raghavendra himself had imbibed and later adhered to in his life. The pictures have been taken after a superficial reading of the writings on him. Instead of Shankachakra Namas, some imperfect marking had been done with fingers. Angara is seen to be sported by all male characters at all times, but Akshata is not seen on their forehead. Yet others are sporting both Angara and Akshata, whereas in the morning only Gopi Chandana should be marked." The response to my feedback was that the persons concerned would speak to me. The following Thursday, the principal character in that serial had come to my shop and asked whether he could see me. I was then at Ayanavaram Mart and my wife informed me of the visit of that person. I told her, since I'd be available in Chennai on both Friday and Saturday, he may come and meet me. Please communicate this to him. But only on Sunday at 7 p.m. I was contacted and I told them that I was going out of station and why they had missed the 2 days indicated to them. We were busy then searching location for the shootings, and if we miss this opportunity of seeing you, we do not have time since we have scheduled the next shooting for tomorrow morning. We have to take shots of the Pattabhishega and have already completed the shooting of Saraswati Bai jumping in the well," they said. So I provided them all the answers they wanted over phone and suggested their meeting a pandit or some Raghavendra Mutt authorities for any further information. It's a pity they had not spent as much time for learning about Sri Guru Raja's life story, the Madhva philosophy and the customs followed by the Madhva sect, as they had devoted for choosing the location for shooting the picture. If they had given due importance to those, such improprieties could have been avoided. Later, they did not contact me again. But in the serial, Sri Raghavendra, Sri Sudhindra, Sri Vijayindra and many others too could be seen sporting Angara Akshata, even early in the morning. They were also seen with Panchakacha. It's only Grihasthas who can wear Panchakacha and not Sannyasis. Madhva women should wear the sari with Kacha, a tuck at the back of the vest. But the characters in this serial did not follow the Madhva tradition. In addition, some portrayals were incorrect historically, revealing gross ignorance of those happenings. A couple of such erroneous depictions are cited below. Sri Sudhindra initiates Sri Yadavendra into Sannyasa Ashrama before Sri Raghavendra takes to sainthood. After Sri Sudhindra recovers from his illness, Sri Yadavendra goes on a missionary tour. Again, when there is a setback in the pontiff's health, Sannyasa Ashrama is conferred on Sri Raghavendra. Later, Sri Sudhindra himself goes on a missionary tour and Sri Yadavendra at that point of time returns to the Srimat. On arrival, he pays his obeisance to Sri Raghavendra as projected in the serial. Sri Raghavendra addresses Sri Yadavendra in singular. That does not conform to civility in the Indian languages and blesses him, which is highly improper. In fact, Sri Yadavendra is higher in his status in the religious hierarchy. Even conceding that he could have been younger to Sri Raghavendra in age, in the monastic order, he is senior to him. Therefore, it is Sri Raghavendra who should prostrate before Sri Yadavendra. Without knowing such rudimentary things and uninformed about Madhva Siddhanta, the serial has been shot. That too interspersed with certain concepts not conforming to the Dvaita ideology. A disciple gets married and on the auspicious occasion, Sri Raghavendra blesses him long life. But the bridegroom dies in the marriage premises itself a little later. Sri Raghavendra is informed about it and the saint then revives him. In another event, some evil-minded persons announce to those around, "Look, Sri Raghavendra is a trickster. We are making this person lie on the floor like a corpse and shall make a pretense of wailing in grief." Eyeing the scene from a distance, he will say that the person cannot be revived. At that time, we shall ask him to get up. Let others go into hiding now. A little later, Sri Raghavendra comes and those wailing there ask him to revive the unfortunate person lying there dead. Sri Raghavendra says, "He's really dead and cannot be brought back to life." The evil-minded group then jeers aloud and utters in chorus, "Look, it is proof that he's a cheat," prompting the person to get up. But he is found to be really dead. At once the group cries, "Swami, please revive him like you have done in another case." Sri Raghavendra then says, "I can bring back to life only those in a deep state of coma, but this person is really dead." Like this, many real incidents of those times are detailed in part 1, and this forms part of the history of that period. In the teleserial, however, it is shown that Sri Raghavendra revives the dead one. This is something not supported by historical facts. The dialogues in these shorts have been adopted from my publication without any change. Unfortunately, without understanding the basic truth behind this incident, it is portrayed that a dead one had been resurrected by Sri Raghavendra. Therefore, the serial carries some historical inaccuracies too. It's not my intention to list out all such flaws. At the same time, it could be surmised that if this serial had been taken after the release of this volume and a thorough reading thereof, the marking of Nama, Angara and Akshata would have been in the appropriate manner. In fact, after talking to me, the Shankachakra mudras were found to have been applied properly. I had mentioned in the end of part 7 that I shall definitely be penning about Gopi Chandana in part 8. And therefore, while touching upon that subject, it became necessary to write about this telecast as well. As mentioned in several places in the earlier volumes, this is not a writing for the present time alone, but one that would serve the posterity too. It is my fervent hope that this work may be useful to the future generations for creating also tele or cinema productions on Sri Raghavendra, encompassing all advancements. To the reader's query as to what I would be doing about this, I have disclosed my plan of action at the end of this writing. I have no idea of finding fault with anyone. I have only vented out my feeling that with more attention and meticulousness, things could have been done in a better way. But I also appreciate the efforts of the producers, as also the talent exhibited in acting, the shooting of scenes and the makeup of the artists by those involved in them. Adverting to Gopi Chandana, Angara and Akshata, they could be sported by all there being no restriction about it. But after reading further, readers could decide themselves about the manner of their application. We've been seeing in various real happenings ascribable to Sri Raghavendra that he has been grazing one and all, language, religion and community being of no consideration to him at all. He has never induced his devotees to come out of the fold of their religious beliefs and practices to earn his grace. The Smartas, Saivites can sport the sacred ash. The Vaishnavites, their religious nama, and the Shaktas, the vermilion. But that does not preclude one from being a devotee of Sri Raghavendra. It's not necessary that one should display Gopi Chandana markings for the reason that Sri Raghavendra has applied those. Sri Raghavendra worships Hari, Hara and Shakti, as also other deities. Even today in his Mantralaya Moola Brindavana, he is meditating upon 72 deities and is submitting our prayers to the appropriate divine being for fulfillment, doing good for all of us. One may worship any deity sporting the marks of one's religious following. That way, the family deity or the divine being of one's choice could be worshipped. And Sri Guru Raja also adored with soulful devotion, exhibiting the marks of one's religious following. Sri Guru Raja, for such devotion, will undoubtedly cause divine grace to be extended for the fruition of one's longing. Since Sri Raghavendra belongs to the line of Sri Madhvacharya's followers, he is sporting Dwadasha Gopi Chandana Namas and Angara Akshata. Madhva saints, Dasas and other followers of the Madhva system of worship have been adhering to this practice from the time of Sri Madhvacharya. But it is not necessary for others to follow this custom. It may be queried as to how I write like this after explaining so much about Gopi Chandana and its glories. In fact, some may feel that Sri Padmanabha Tirtha, the principal disciple of Sri Madhvacharya, had embraced the Dvaita system only from a different religious patronage. But in a complete transformation like that, the adoption of Madhva system of worship, encompassing things like the Gopi Chandana marking, etc., is not improper. My object here is to drive home the message that it is not necessary to metamorphose oneself in such a manner to worship Sri Raghavendra. It is also opined that by some that the marking of Angara Akshata has come into vogue only after the period of Sri Madhvacharya. I reiterate that the sacred Gopi Chandana can be applied by all. It is not necessary that, like the Madhvas, Dvadasha Namas and Angara Akshata should essentially be worn. The religious marks of one's following may first be worn according to the custom. Later, Gopi Chandana streak on the forehead could be applied and that should suffice. Otherwise, on the forehead, in the chest and at the appropriate places on the two shoulders, they could be marked. Whatever benefits are to be derived by the Dvadasha Namas, they can be had by following the method suggested. If felt necessary, some more markings may be added also. To know about Gopi Talab, the source of the sacred Gopi Chandana, the clue for finding it is that the Lord had caused the creation of two places in the sea, one for his governance and another as an abode for him. It is between these locations only that the sacred Gopi Talab exists now.